All right, welcome everyone. We'll get started here. I'm Andy Johnson with Defenders Wildlife. I'm glad you could join us for this presentation on the cultural significance of sea otters. We have Monica LeFlore with Defenders also on the webinar. She's managing behind the scenes. And I would like to begin by acknowledging that I'm speaking from the Monterey Peninsula in California, which forms a portion of the traditional lands of what is now the Ohlone, Coast Noan, Esplanade Nation. And Defenders of Wildlife's mission is to protect all native animals and plants in their natural communities. We envision a future where diverse wildlife populations in North America are secure and thriving, sustained by a network of healthy lands and waters. I can't think of a presentation that would align more closely with our mission and our vision than the one we have to share this afternoon. But just real quick for this webinar, all attendees will be on mute and off camera. So please feel free to just kick back and relax. We won't be staring at you. Also, please submit questions you have at any time using Zoom's Q&A feature. Just navigate down to the bottom and it should pop up at the bottom of your screen. So click on the Q&A and submit any questions that way. And before we get to our presentation, I'm going to introduce Heather Barrett, who's a science communication director and research scientist with Sea Otter Savvy. And she's going to tell us a bit about the We Were Here campaign.
Great. Thank you so much, Andy. Hi, everyone. I'm just going to share my screen for one moment. I have a few things to show you. So yeah, hi, everyone. I'm a sea otter biologist. My name's Heather Barrett, and I'm the science communication director with Sea Otter Savvy. So first off, welcome to our sixth day of Sea Otter Awareness Week. And thank you guys for joining us on a Friday afternoon. Hopefully you guys are relaxing. And also a big thank you to Defenders of Wildlife for hosting this presentation and to Alaka Alliance for partnering with us for this special event. But I wanted to give you guys a little bit of a background. Sea Otter Awareness Week happens every year during the last week of September, and it's organized in partnership with Sea Otter Savvy, Defenders of Wildlife, and California State Parks. And each year we have a different theme to emphasize what's new with sea otter research and conservation for the year. And this year's theme is ecosystem mosaic. And it really follows the idea that the sea otter's ecosystem is a mosaic. It's made up of tiny parts that if one of those key elements is removed, that can have damage to the system structure and ultimately render that ecological picture incomplete. And so here you can see with the final logo, all the pieces in place to form a healthy ecosystem and a healthy community. But this also marks the sixth event of our We Were Here Sea Otter program. Sea Otter Savvy's We Were Here Sea Otter program is dedicated to educating communities and stakeholders who are missing sea otters. And the California Sea Otter Range is currently only a little north of Año Nuevo State Park, all the way down to Gaviota State Park in the south. But sea otters historically were found all the way up through the Pacific coast, and they're ecologically as well as culturally significant. And there's increasing discussion regarding possible range expansion and possible reintroduction. So to move forward, government agencies and sea otter research community really need to hear from you. We need to gauge stakeholder opinions. And so sea otters, like other fish and wildlife populations in the US, are held in public trust. And what that means is that the government is managing and protecting these resources to benefit the public, which is you guys. Therefore, all of your voices and opinions matter, and the public is ultimately going to decide the fate of sea otters. And we really would love to hear your perspectives, whether that be support or concerns regarding this matter. So if at the end of this presentation, you are wondering what you can personally do, please take the stakeholder survey. You are a stakeholder, even though you might not think you are, you are. So if you don't have to be in California, if you're out of state, that's fantastic. Even out of country, we wanna hear from you. And so the links for the website, I believe, are gonna be put into the Q&A function of this. And it's also gonna be made available to you guys afterwards when this video is posted. So please take the survey and share it with others. And without further ado, I'll hand it back to Andy, who's going to introduce our speaker this evening, Peter Hatch. Thank you guys.
Thanks, Heather. As you said, I'll introduce our speaker tonight, Peter Hatch. Peter graduated magna cum laude from Brown University. He works as a historical researcher and cultural resources technician with the Confederated Tribes of Siletz Indians, and also serves as secretary on the board of directors of the Alaka Alliance. Over the years, I had many conversations with Peter's father, Dave Hatch, about his vision for the Alaka Alliance to restore sea otters along the coast of Oregon. So it's a real privilege to have Peter with us to share the cultural significance of sea otters in the Pacific Northwest. So Peter, take it away.
Thank you, Andy, and thank you to Defenders of Wildlife and Sea Otter Savvy for hosting us this afternoon. Let me put in both AirPods to make sure that the sound is as good as it can be, and let's fire up this presentation. Hello everyone. Peter Sagas Hatch, Wam Nashi. Peter Black Bear Hatch is my name. I'm a member of the Confederated Tribes of Siletz Indians of Coos and Shayushla descent. I'm really happy to be addressing you guys this evening. My perspective is kind of focused on the Oregon coast, where the people that make up our Confederated tribe originally come from before being forced together onto the reservation. I don't even really, I'm not an elected member of tribal council. I don't even speak for my tribal government. I certainly don't speak for, Yurok folks and Tolowa folks and Pomo folks and Miwok folks all the way down the California coast in the rest of the area that is missing sea otters. I'm here tonight speaking for myself, but I think that some of the information that we've been able to put together as the Alaka Alliance is of value and can inform approaches to all of the places where sea otters are missing from their former range. So I'm really glad to be with you. And with that introduction, let's begin. So the Ohlone Alliance, we're an organization that is aimed at restoring a healthy population of sea otters to the Oregon coast and thereby make Oregon's marine ecosystem more robust and resilient. In order to do that, we have kind of twin goals of outreach and communications on the one hand and scientific research on the other. In order to, as well as we can, both understand and communicate the potential effects of our reintroduction. And once we feel like we've been able to achieve a regional consensus, or at least as close to one as we're able, only then would we wanna proceed with a reintroduction of sea otters in Oregon. If that proves to be feasible, that is our ultimate and very deeply cherished goal. I'm gonna assume that the folks tuning in tonight understand the difference between a sea otter and a river otter. We can go over it in the Q&A at the end if anybody's having trouble, because it can be a little confusing when you're out there in the wild. And we get a lot of nominal sea otter sightings up here in Oregon that obviously turn out to be river otters foraging in estuaries or in the intertidal zone. Just to review, if anyone's coming to this fresh, there are just a couple of fundamental facts of sea otter biology that affect everything that I'm going to be talking about tonight and their interactions with humans and with their ecosystem. So the first is that sea otters sustain themselves by eating just an incredible proportion of their body weight each and every day of in invertebrates to keep that little furnace inside them going. And that means that they have a disproportionate effect on the ecosystem around them. They punch way above their weight. The other thing is that unlike other marine mammals along our coast, they don't have a layer of blubber to place between themselves and the cold ocean around them. And so their adaptation is the thickest, softest fur of any animal on Earth. And that is the fundamental fact of their biology that colors their interactions with humans over the long course of time. The other thing to know is, as Heather said so ably, there are no sea otters on the Oregon coast, nor in much of the Northern California coast. That is that has been true. The last Oregon sea otter that we've been able to find a record of was killed in 1910, just a year before the international fur seal treaty went into effect, an international agreement between the global hunting powers that protected them. So for several generations now, we have lacked sea otters on the Oregon coast. And a lot of my work and my dad's work before me was trying to understand and weigh the importance of a species that's been absent from living memory. So all of our baselines, all of our expectations for what should be off of our coast is shifted because of that fact. And there are lots of ways to try and understand that. There are lots of lines of evidence to go to. But for me, in casting out for a place to begin understanding the importance of this species and the fact that it's missing, I start with a story told by a brilliant, vivacious indigenous Oregon coast woman named Annie Miner Peterson, who's been lost to us for about 80 years now. She was a woman who lived a very full life, and in her older years, when she was about 75, a linguist and ethnographer from the University of Washington came rambling on down the coast, trying to collect what he could from Indian elders and languages. He soon expected to be dead. And from his work, from their summer together, Melville Jacobs and Annie, they record a lot of what we know about the Hannes and Millet dialects of the Coos language around what's now Coos Bay, Oregon, or indigenous to that area. One of the many, many stories that she told during that summer was a story about brilliant, independently minded young woman, not unlike Annie herself, who lived back at a time when the boundaries between the human world and the animal world were a lot more fluid than we see them as today. And she would refuse to marry anybody, but one day, after becoming magically pregnant while out swimming and giving birth to a son and being cast out by her family for her and this strange fatherless baby, she meets the child's father, who turns out to be a young headman of the sea otter people, who takes her out to live out to sea, and they raise another son. And after a couple of years, she returns with canoe loads of gifts from the ocean, from out among the sea otter people, to solemnize the marriage, to make it right. And her children continue to hunt along the shore and bring the good things that the people need, the whales and the seals and the things that the things that the people rely upon for their prosperity. And that relationship carries on down the generations. The story ends with saying that referring to her children, the sea otters, as long as the people are alive that long, we will see her children, the sea otters. And the relationship that is implied there, whether you are the type of person to take stories of this kind literally or not, is important. It is a big fat red underline to me that this is a species that we should care about, that this is a part of the web of relationships that our folks as coastal indigenous people have always relied upon for our prosperity, and that all of us today rely upon for the vitality of the ecosystems that human life depends upon. That is just part of a broader web. You know, if we were to get to know each other after this webinar and go together to my Zoom background here, our dance house on the Siletz Reservation. If you were come around solstice time, you could sit and enjoy with me our nadash, our feather dance that we do at that time, to put on all of the most beautiful regalia made from the wonderful things that come from our land, the abalone, the woodpecker scarlet, the ringtails, the eagle feathers, in order to express again that relationship of and stewardship and to go through to go through the rituals that in our view ensure the continuance of that bounty that we've always relied upon. And among those items of value, you know, all those things I mentioned, you know, the dentalia necklace that I'm wearing here this evening. Among all those things, the kind of most beautiful, valuable expression that comes from our environment in former times was the sea otter and their beautiful, warm pelts. And that's all over when you talk to other elders when you look through the records of long past elders whose knowledge we still rely upon today. It's all over talking about sea otters and their role. You'll have to forgive Frank Drew, my family's old neighbor, talking back in the 1930s, comparing the value of a sea otter hide to the value of a woman. But what he means there is that, again, in that relationship of solemnizing marriages between a prospective groom and his prospective in-laws, coming up with a big expression of gratitude, a big gift to make the marriage right, is a part of that process and always has been. And one of the most valuable things that you could do to enact that marriage would be to give a sea otter skin. You know, Oregon in former times is a really linguistically diverse place. There are six different words for sea otter as you go up and down the coast, all, you know, completely different from one another. I think it's a good indication that there's no part of the coast where they were absent, even though our rocky habitat off the coast of Oregon is pretty patchy. There are many indications of sea otter's abundance consistently throughout the archaeological studies of the middens, basically the leftovers of the lifeways of villages up and down the coast, and the mussel shells and everything else. Among marine mammal bones, right behind the pinnipeds, the second most common kind of marine mammal bone found in the middens is the sea otter. Traditional ecological knowledge is a really popular thing to talk about in conservation and ecological management kind of issues right now. There's all kinds of little details of scattered pieces of TEK that we can try our best to put together and make meaning of. All kinds of places where clearly, because sea otters were known to be harvested there, even by people who were being interviewed, 30, 40 years after Oregon sea otters were gone, that knowledge is there. There's a presence in the culture, in the lives of our people that extends beyond when they were extirpated from our lands and our waters. some other things about that in the landscape of Oregon today. You know, there are places called Otter Rock and Otter Point. And indeed, when you look back at the indigenous place names for those people, for those places, they are just, again, quite literally Sea Otter Rock, which suggests to me that, you know, those are very likely basically places that sea otters have frequented and gathered around as long as sea levels have been near their current level. And if you plot the different accounts of harvest and stories and those kind of things that I've been talking about up against a habitat map for where we would expect there to be a dense sea otter population, if they were to be restored to Oregon and eventually went many, many generations down the road reach carrying capacity, it's a pretty much a one-to-one with the places our folks always knew and continued to talk about even after sea otters were gone. And so that web of relationships, that knowledge, that sustainable hunting of sea otters by our people for thousands of years was interrupted suddenly in the blink of an eye, and in a way that has a great deal to do with why my life looks the way it does. If you're a resident of Oregon or California, a lot of why your life looks the way it does. And what I mean by that is that what do sea otters have to do with all of us? So if we look at this map here, that's a British map from about 1775, you'll see that our whole northwest coast is practically a blank. And sea otters have an awful lot to do with how it is that that map gets filled in and how our little region on the eastern coast of the world's biggest ocean comes under the sway of the different world powers that were contending with one another at the time. And so we can begin that story with the Qing dynasty, a family from Manchuria in northern China that takes over the empire in the 1600s, and their kind of woodsy northern tastes really affect the whole imperial hierarchy and bureaucracy, and suddenly furs are the thing to have. And so that fur boom kind of rolls across all of northeastern Asia as that market feeds that demand. And around the same time, the empresses of Russia ruling in the early 1700s, Catherine the Great and Empress Anna, also are expanding out into the furthest reaches of their territory and want to start sending explorers to find out exactly what it is they own and whether they can get a piece of everything that that other world powers are extracting from the Americas. And so a couple of different times they dispatch Vitus Bering to the sea and the island that now bear his name. And he died in the attempt, but his crew returning to Kamchatka had gained knowledge and interest in the only people around who were real successful, efficient hunters of the sea otter, the indigenous Aleut people of, or Wenangah people of the Aleutian chain. And further Russian entrepreneurs return and to exploit those people and have crews of their baidarkas to go wherever they could manage to sail and wherever they could find populations of sea otters, slaughter them and keep on moving in a way that had, continued along the Aleutian chain and then down through Southeast Alaska and just on and on. until you know, their southernmost base where they got started was Fort Ross in Northern California. And as other powers start to get in on this action and all the money that's being made, it is a wholesale slaughter of sea otters in order to feed this demand on the other side of the Pacific by the British, by the Spanish, and indeed by the expanding United States. So one of the first American ships in the waters of the of our coast just a year after the Constitution gets signed is the Lady Washington, and they come along off Salmon River off Lincoln City here in Oregon in August of 1788 and trade with a couple Salmon River guys out in a canoe for sea otter skins, and they're the first Americans in the neighborhood, but they're not the first Europeans, because half of the crew of six that they meet out in that canoe is already marked by smallpox, by the effects that are coming from the rapid integration and exploitation of our region as we get thrust into the global economy. And indeed, a few years later, in Thomas Jefferson's instructions to Meriwether Lewis, he says explicitly in his letter of instruction to go and see if Lewis and Clark are able to find and exploit the kind of resources that the British are making so much money on up at Nootka Sound and other places where they base their sea otter trade. A few years after that, they make poor Sacagawea there in that picture trade one of her prized possessions, her blue beaded belt, to some traders at the mouth of the Columbia River so that they can finally secure their sea otter skin to bring back to Jefferson. And so by the time this fur boom has kind of spent itself both by sea and by land, and our region is so badly affected. The waves of disease are coming through indigenous communities, and then subsequent to that, the United States cements its territorial claim here and starts giving away chunks of land before they've secured title to it. By the time all of those kind of mid-19th century catastrophes are happening, in some ways, the sea otter hunting that we know about in Oregon is really just kind of mopping up the leftovers of that once abundant population. And there are human costs to this process, and the disasters that were unfolding for the sea otter population and for many other species throughout the Pacific Northwest were happening to the people there too. So here's my great-great-grandpa Isaac Martin and his only living daughter Hattie Martin, who lost 8 siblings before her time to the tuberculosis that ran so rampant, and you know, for earlier generations, to the smallpox, to the malaria, to the other things that came to the loss of land and the loss of sovereignty. And so in many ways these processes exist in parallel. It just so happens that contrary to that story of Annie's that I began with, we survived and the sea otters did not, just by chance, at least here in Oregon. Again, this is the article that we've been able to find, just a little blurb in the Coos Bay Times that represents the last Oregon sea otter that we have record of. And that $500 that Mr. 40 sold it for, I think is about 6,000 or 7,000 today. So at the end of all of that process, there are just kind of small survivor communities throughout the original range of sea otters. And it's so fortunate that I think it, you know, California's population derives back from about, I think it's 30 some animals that managed to survive on the Big Sur coast. And subsequent to that, there was an attempt to reintroduce them several places along the coast, including Oregon. 93 animals were brought back to Oregon, and they seemed to be doing okay for a couple of years, although there was a lot of initial mortality, but eventually just dropped down beyond the point of being able to sustain their population and dwindled away. Fortunately, in Washington, British Columbia, and Southeast Alaska, they were able to hang on and have successful reintroductions. And what that leaves us with, even still, is this 800-mile gap of sea otter habitat. And the question, in addition to what that means for people and for culture and for our relationship, is also what it means for our environment. And I think this is something that others can speak about more eloquently than me, but and again, in case anyone's coming to it fresh, in many ways, modern ecology is catching up to that understanding of interrelatedness that go back to the kinds of stories that I opened this talk with. And one case of that is a good friend of our organization, Jim Estes, who as a grad student back in the 70s out in the Aleutians, was able to observe the differences between the islands that had an extant sea otter population and those that did not. And the way in which sea otters are the guardians of our kelp forests and have such a disproportionate effect, called a trophic cascade, on the other, on the very shape and form of the environment that they exist in. And as such, they're kind of one of the most seminal examples of a keystone species. And the same processes that Estes was observing are still taking place right off our coast. There are lots of former kelp forests that are being converted to urchin barren. Here at Port Orford, there used to be a pretty active purple urchin industry for commercial purposes. As that has dwindled, you know, those divers were kind of serving a lot of the same ecosystem function that sea otters would otherwise be doing. As that industry has dwindled, urchin barrens are mowing down kelp forests off the southern Oregon coast. This is an active process that is still going on, in addition to the just fundamental shift in our baselines from the absence of otters for the last 110 years. And so this absence of kelp or this reduction in kelp canopy has a whole bunch of effects throughout the near shore ecosystem. I don't want to abuse too much of my time. So I'll just say that in addition to providing like multi-story habitat within the near shore, there are incredible benefits to the nutrients that that kelp are able to absorb and toss up as racked that supports small invertebrates, that support larger birds. There are also there's also a tremendous amount more carbon stored per acre in a healthy kelp forest versus an urchin barren. In our changing climate, every little bit helps. Sea otters in estuaries, it's been observed, of course, have a disproportionate effect also in terms of the way that their foraging on those invertebrates can change plant communities and the fundamental shape of even all the way down to water quality.
because of, again, that disproportionate effect that they have. For all of these reasons that are ecological, that are cultural, that are historical, I believe that we owe these animals a debt, and that their absence is meaningful, and that it's worth our time, that it's worth our involvement to try to correct the wrong that we as humans have perpetrated on them. And that's why I'm part of this Ilaca Alliance organization, and that's why I'm proud to be part of all my brilliant, eloquent colleagues here, and the other organizations that we've had the great fortune to work with. And we're making a lot of progress on this issue. Just recently, we released the initial draft of a feasibility study that will be finalized by the end of the year, that we hope will be able to lay the groundwork for an Oregon reintroduction. And to talk more about that, I want to turn it over to my esteemed colleague, our Outreach and Communications Director for Ilaca Alliance, Chanel Hasen. So she is, I'm hoping she'll just be able to take over speaker view if I'm mute.
Yes, let me share my screen. All right. Can you see it? Thumbs up, thumbs down. I'm gonna take the silence as a yes. All right, hi everyone. My name is Chanel Hasen, as Peter mentioned, and I'm the Director of Outreach and Community Relations for the Ilaca Alliance. And so I'm gonna just speak really quickly on our feasibility study draft. So this is a complex scientific feasibility study that will assist the Ilaca Alliance, state and federal agencies, ocean users, and the public in understanding, evaluating, and addressing the many complex factors that must be considered before a decision is made to return sea otters to the Oregon coast. So a final document will be produced in January 2022 after comments are received. We also have an economic impact assessment that is still being worked on at the moment that should be available later this year. So meet the dream team of scientists that help author this fantastic feasibility study. We have Dr. Tim Tinker, Dr. James Estes, Dr. James Bodkin, Dr. Sean Larson, Dr. Mike Murray, and Dr. Jan Hodder. So this team of six leading scientists evaluated key dimensions of a proposed sea otter reintroduction here in Oregon. And a centerpiece to this draft feasibility study is an Oregon sea otter population model, also known as ORSO, created by Dr. Tim Tinker. It's an online computer model system that can be used by anyone to run various scenarios of future sea otter populations based on how many animals are released and where. So that'll come up in a couple slides. So keep that in the back of your mind. So the draft feasibility study can be found on our website, www.ilacaalliance.org, until November 30th. We have chapter summaries, thanks to myself and also Andy Johnson here, our partner with Defenders, who helped create short little summaries for you for these complex chapters. But we also have the full chapters available for download as well. We have an online feedback form provided on the website if you scroll all the way to the bottom. And the feasibility study covers such factors as the location and suitability of habitats for sea otters, the potential for positive and negative effects on Oregon's marine and estuarine ecosystems, possible social and economic impacts, the health and veterinary aspects of sea otter return, administrative and legal requirements, logistical constraints, and steps for implementation. So you can tell this is a very, very thorough document. I'm now going to review quickly the top five conclusions from this draft study. Number one, the reintroduction through translocation of sea otters has been the most important management action contributing to the species recovery from near extinction in regions of eastern North Pacific. Approximately 30% of global sea otter abundance can be attributed to reintroductions to Southeast Asia, British Columbia, and Washington. Reintroductions have increased species viability, helped recover genetic diversity, and improve gene flow in sea otter populations. That's wonderful. Number two, a spatially explicit population model that I mentioned earlier. Developed specifically for evaluating potential sea otter reintroductions to Oregon, shows that reintroduced population or populations of sea otters is likely to be viable, assuming sufficient numbers of animals are released to appropriate habitats. When combined with the analysis of habitat suitability, this model suggests several areas, mostly along the southern Oregon coast, that would likely support a successful reintroduction. Woohoo! Fantastic. Number three, in addition to nearshore ocean habitats, several estuaries in Oregon may offer suitable habitat for a founding sea otter population. Using this estuarine release sites could help the potential for successfully establishing a population center, especially close to a suitable nearshore ocean habitat. Number four, as a keystone species, sea otters have immensely strong effects on the nearshore ecosystems that they inhabit, much like Peter was talking about earlier. Impacts associated with sea otter recovery include direct effects on prey species, some of which currently support commercially important fisheries, such as Dungeness crab. While predation by sea otters on some shellfish species, sorry, say that three times fast, could have negative social and economic effects, indirect While predation by sea otters on some shellfish species could have negative social and economic effects, indirect ecosystem effects could prove beneficial, such as increases in finfish and invertebrate species that rely on kelp and eelgrass, increases in overall biodiversity and productivity, and increases in carbon capture and fixation. Last but not least, reintroductions of sea otters can only occur if socioeconomic and regulatory issues are fully addressed. Outreach and engagement with a broad array of affected stakeholders are essential to ensuring that decisions about reintroductions have considered all the relevant factors and have a broad base of support. So there you go, short and sweet summary for you all. I have a little plug on some Alaska Alliance events coming up that you are all welcome to participate in. We have a Sea Otter Science Symposium taking place in several weeks, October 5th through 7th. It's a virtual event, so you can join from the comfort of your own home. You can register online on our website, just click the events tab. Same with our webinar coming up on October 21st at 6:30 Pacific time about marine birds and kelp from a local photographer. And then we have an Oregon Otter Beer Challenge, the first ever. We have 14 breweries participating in a special otter brew. So stay tuned for more information on that. And be sure, if you haven't checked out our website, you can sign up for our email newsletter, The Raft, and you can follow all our updates on social media, Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and YouTube. And just want to thank the Sea Otter Savvy, Heather, and everyone there for the We Were Here program, and California State Parks, and of course, Defenders of Wildlife for having us on this evening. So excited to answer your questions. Thank you.
Great. Well, thanks, Peter and Chanel. That was a wonderful presentation. I think, you know, I spend most of my time sort of focusing on the, you know, the tragedy that occurred to sea otters, but it's so hard to decouple, you know, this sort of environmental tragedy from the human tragedy that occurred as well. Let's see, we had one question that I see Peter answered, but maybe you could just, lost everything. Maybe you could pass that along for the group. Stephanie had asked, what does the term harvest place refer to? And she was asking if that means the sustainable hunting areas.
Yeah, that's just, so again, a lot of what we know about hunting off of the Oregon coast, you know, way back in the day, we have to take from the oral tradition as captured of folks who were alive a long time after Oregon sea otters were gone. And so there are just a few very specific places, though, that come up again and again as associated with sea otters, people have specific accounts about, you know, their grandparents going and hunting sea otters, and those are the places that I put on that chart. And those correlate really strongly with where we would expect them to be if they did indeed return.
I had a question. What cultural benefits would you hope to see with the return of sea otters to indigenous communities in Oregon?
Yeah, I think that fundamentally, although these effects are hard to quantify, I think all of the indirect effects of a healthier nearshore, better kelp coverage, and the downstream of effects of that environment on all kinds of other species that we rely on, anadromous fish especially, where, juvenile salmonid seem to favor the cover that's provided to them by kelp and, all of the invertebrates and prey species that are in a healthier nearshore. You know, it's part of just one of the most fundamental shifts that's taken place in our coast. For so many other things, there are huge shifts that have happened and still are happening, and great and terrible uncertainties facing us in the future. But sea otters are one of the few major important animals off of our coast that are completely gone. Everything else is, may not be hanging on well, like our red abalone is really struggling. We're just coming through a terrible few years of sea star wasting that seems to be starting to alleviate somewhat. And who knows what's coming at us in the future? I certainly don't. I'm not a biologist. And I think that building resilience into the system by having sea otters back is part of what I hope to see.
Okay. Yeah, a question from Sherry, sort of echoed by another question from Lauren. Were the sea otters involved in the failed introduction to Oregon northern sea otters? And are there reasons to think that that southern sea otters could be reintroduced more successfully?
It's certainly possible. So it does seem like from recent studies by folks who have been looking at the genetics of sea otters in Oregon's middens, that Oregon may have, to some extent, been a transitional area between northern and southern sea otters, and perhaps before the populations were so incredibly separated by the fur trade, kind of represent poles of a range of variation, and that there would have been gene flow between the two subspecies, possibly. And so one of the things the feasibility study contemplates as a possibility would be a population of northern sea otters in kind of the northern part of their missing range, such as in Oregon and southern species in either southern Oregon or northern California, in order to reestablish that gene flow and bring them to something like back there, the natural expected condition if they existed in their whole range. But yes, so the otters brought to Oregon in the 70s were part of a basically the Department of Energy's effort to conduct nuclear testing on Chitka Island out in the Aleutians. And fortunately, conservationists were able to insist that before you blow this island up, you've got to do something about at least some of these sea otters. And so in order to try to make something good out of this, that's what kind of led down the path of those reintroduction efforts. So those were northern otters, and a lot of them did disappear initially right after they were placed in Oregon. So it could be that they joined up with the Washington reintroductions, which were also northern sea otters, and that population is very healthy today, surprisingly so. Basically northern versus southern is definitely something that is on our minds, but it seems like either one could have a place in Oregon to some degree or another.
Yeah, if I can chime in there real fast. The study concludes that Southeast Alaska and the Olympic coast of Washington have enough animals to serve as a possible source population. We're also talking with the Monterey Bay Aquarium if they have any of their SORAC rehabilitated sea otters possibly to use as well in the reintroduction. So currently we don't have exactly the exact locations yet, but in due time.
I had a quick question about carbon sequestration and sea otter's role in that. You referred to it a little bit in your talk, but you just run through that one more time?
Sure, yeah. Just the basic idea is that even though up here, as opposed to down in California, we have a bulk up environment. So it's an annual that kind of dies back in that seasonal cycle. The incredibly fast growth of kelp every year stores a lot of carbon. And as that is either, you know, falls to the ocean floor as it dies back or washes out onto the beach, it provides nutrients or stores carbon in a lot of ecologically beneficial ways. And so I don't really know too much about how to, it's really has been a struggle for our colleagues who are working on an economic impact assessment of a potential Oregon sea otter reintroduction to try to quantify those effects, just because it's many kind of steps down the road from a reintroduction to the eventual expected outcomes that those are going to have. But that's something that we are trying to learn more about or trying to make good assumptions about as we pursue reintroduction here in Oregon. Chanel, do you have anything to add on that?
Okay. And a question about the populations in Washington State and around the Olympic Peninsula, sort of how are they doing? And they asked if we could point them to a source for the answer. If we couldn't handle it, I can provide that, but you may have some other information.
I used to have a slide on that in this presentation. I think it is like in that general zone. I think it's in the range of like 5,500 otters. Does that sound about right to you, Chanel?
Sounds a little high. But...
Oh, okay.
I'm not sure.
Yeah, maybe Andy, you would know better than I. But in any case, they are kind of, doing quite well off of the Olympic Peninsula, but are rarely seen on the southern Washington coast. Basically about once a year, we get a confirmed sighting of a single otter here off of the Oregon coast that is confirmed to indeed be a sea otter. And that tends to be like single animals, behaviorally, usually young males kind of out to look for a good time that lose their way and find their way all the way down in Oregon and either die or return north. So unfortunately, although that population is stable and doing pretty well, they are not expanding their range southward at a rate that would bring them to Oregon in a way that has any real chance of alleviating these kind of issues about urchin barrens and the general poor state of our nearshore ecosystem that I brought up earlier. You know, it would be great if they could do it on their own, but it doesn't seem like things are headed that way at this time.
Yeah, I think that I have in my head there's something like 2,000 and something otters in
Washington.
You. But
that sounds better. Yeah.
And sort of attached to that is this aspect of you know our linear coastline, and that's as Peter mentioned the big gap that exists between South and San Francisco and Central Washington State, where these animals really can only go one direction or the other to expand their range, and it's difficult and challenging. So, as Peter said, these explorer animals who head south into Oregon occasionally, unless they can establish and pave the way for other animals move down, it's going to happen very slowly, and it's not happening right now. So, that maybe gets into what could be our last question here from Jim. Which just talks about how much traction does this reintroduction effort have? What steps remain to be taken and what roadblocks are there? There aren't any roadblocks, are there?
Never.
Never.
You want me to take this on, Peter?
Sure.
So we've actually, when I joined on in March and over the last several years, we've had a lot of traction, and this feasibility study was super huge in this process and has never been done before. So it's moving pretty quickly. We want to give plenty of time for people to read and digest the feasibility study draft and give us feedback, both on the study and the whole idea of restoring sea otters to the Oregon coast. So after we get all those comments back, we hope to have a final version by the end of January, as I mentioned. In the meantime, U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service is working on a report to Congress on restoring sea otters along the Pacific coast, which is due at the end of December. So early next year, we'll sit down with them, with the U.S. Fish and Wildlife Service to discuss the next steps. So obviously, this involves a lot of stakeholders. If there are roadblocks, we are open to discussion with anybody who has any opposition to try and work out the best possible scenario for all of us.
Yeah, and I thank you so much, Chanel, that's exactly right. And just one point to make for that question as well, is this stakeholder survey that's out right now with the We Were Here Sea Otter program, that information that you guys give to us is going to be given to those in discussion for December. So it's an active way for you guys to be able to share information, concerns, support, whatever it is that you have to say. If you can add it into the survey, this is the time to do it. It will all be analyzed and given to them to think about and discuss before December occurs. So I think I'm supposed to be able to share one last time since apparently there's something going on with the chat function. So if you guys can see this, this is the website down below. And if you search in for We Were Here Sea Otters, it will pop up. But there's also this that you guys can use. If you know how to use a QR code, you can take your phone out. You can open up the photo function and just point it right in front and it will pop up at the top. So I'll give everyone a moment there, but I know that I was told to add that there. But yes, if you guys can share your voices, it's really important, you know, from Oregon to California, I think we're really in a partnership here. We are so excited that the feasibility study is out. We're really excited to see where that goes. And I think those of us in Northern California are really happy about that. I'll stop the share.
Well, take the survey for sure, but I'll just send my thanks to Peter very much for your presentation. That was wonderful. Thanks to Chanel for updates on the ALAC Alliance. Thanks everybody for attending. And we'll just wrap things up. And we have a couple more Sea Otter Awareness Week events. There's a paint night tomorrow night. And there's one more event sort of after the fact. The Marine Mammal Center has a couple of folks, the Harrises, who are gonna talk about their experiences helping for the recovery of sea otters on Monday. Sometime I'd have to look it up myself. But just go to Defenders of the Wildlife's Sea Otter Awareness Week webpage, and you can get those last details there. And thank you very much for attending.
Thank you.
Thank you, guys.
Thank you.